grace, mercy, and peace to you all. In the name of God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen. If you join me in a word of prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, especially that in this day we may see where real power lies. That in Jesus you have blessed us, you have gifted us with a power beyond all power. Lord, today may we cling to that, and it may be our hope, not just for this day, but for all our days. We ask this, Jesus, in your name. Amen. So, a couple of things that I really enjoy about reading Scripture. One of the things, I know, like, Pastor enjoys reading Scripture, that's great. One of the things that I really enjoy about reading Scripture is that you're able to kind of look at the church as it has been from the time of Jesus beginning his ministry and wandering off. He makes this call and people come and they answer the call. But the other thing, you kind of see also how this actually works kind of a little bit down the line. And especially as we look to the word of Paul in Corinth, this church that exists there, the thing that you see is that there's really no golden age for the church. There's really, as you populate the church with people who are sinful, there's really never a time where everything is perfect. And you just don't have that. And so you see that, especially as we look into Corinthians. There's something about these Corinthian verses that really just kind of captured me in this last week. And I'm just looking because you have this picture of a church that is utterly and ridiculously divided. You have this division that goes on, and Paul is looking at it, he's like, how did we get to this? How did we get to this as God's people? How do we come to this moment? And one of the things that they, reading some commentaries, they were pretty quick to indicate that this wasn't like a theological dispute. This isn't the Lutherans versus the Catholics versus the Presbyterians versus whomever. That the stuff happening in Corinth was really this question of who's going to be in control of our little corner of organization, right? The fundamental problem that is going on in the Corinthian church is a question of power. Who will have power? Now, if you've ever been in a divided church, you've ever experienced that kind of division, perhaps you've ever been in a divided workplace, if that would help you understand, or maybe a divided country, you can understand, perhaps, that division is not super great. That division causes all sorts of pain, all sorts of conflict, all sorts of heartache. And one of the great reasons for division is who is going to have power? How is that? Who should have it? Who should have it? Who has power? That's one question. You know, you look to the church, who has power in our church? Is it me as a pastor? Am I the most powerful individual in the church? Some of you are like, yeah, of course you are. I'm looking at you, I'm like, no, I can see a couple others who have maybe a lot more power than me, right? And then there is the question, who should have power, right? And of course, I always think it should be me. I do, right? And I think in most of the times when we come to these moments of church, people, it should be me, or it should be at least somebody who agrees with me, right? That's the way it should be, right? Who should have power? I mean, look around your room here. Who should be the one who's in charge? You see anybody got any good obvious candidates? Russ is volunteering for power, and he's up there, so he gets to lord it over us. Right? That's great. The other question of power is what do people do with it when they have it? What you, of course, would be a benevolent dictator, Russ. Benevolent. Your benevolence would know no ends.
Yes.
Right. And are we going to use power for good? Are we going to use power for our good, for my good? Are we going to use power for the good of all, or how is power going to work? In the church in Corinth, the church forever, and in human organizations, we've always had these struggles around power. And Paul, no less, with the church in Corinth, even though, here's the problem. Paul, when he's looking at the church, when he says, I don't want you to be like this. The church is something different. You look into politics, you look into workplaces, you look into other organizations, yet there's going to be the questions of power in all of those places. And that's never going to go away, right? You don't have to, in 4 years, if we vote for somebody else, this country votes and chooses some other president, there's still going to be a question of power. And then 4 years after that, there's still going to be a question of power. And 4 years after that, there will still be a question of power. The questions of power in the human organizations will never go away. Paul says, you, the church, are something different. Because he witnesses the divisions in the church. He witnesses there's quarreling among them. There's these times and these places where people are saying, I follow Paul. And right in, like, man, don't you love that one? Like, I'm totally with whatever Jim says. Right? Jim, that does a whole bunch for the Jim ego. Like, pastors behind me, it's all 100%, right? I follow David. David's like, yes, pastor, as you should. I followed Gail back there. Gail's like, but no, I didn't want the power. But Gail, now I follow you. You're the one. This is the church that Paul finds himself in. This is the church that he's looking at. And he says, I follow Paul. I follow Apollos. I follow Cephas. This is Peter. I follow Christ. These people in this place, he's witnessing these divisions and he's saying, this is not of God. God's power is not found in the ways in which we divide ourselves. Now, again, this is not about a theological dispute. One of the questions about who has power in the church is how they're going to use it. Who's going to be brought in? Who's going to be left out? Who's going to be cared for? Who's not going to be cared for? How are we going to use the money, the wealth that we have? How should we use it? Paul witnesses the division. He says, no, don't be like this. So I want to just illustrate this seeking of power with this story. Story of this, a cop is driving down the street and he gets to the corner and he looks out and there under the street light, there's a man who's crawling around and the cop looks and he's like, what is he doing? Like there's a problem here. He gets out and the man has obviously had at least a few too many to be doing anything reasonable or sane, right? And so he cop goes up to him and he's like, sir, is there a problem? Like, what's going on? And the man kind of slurs his speech a little bit and he says, well, officer, I lost my wallet. The cop says, oh, well, you know, that's good, I'm not here. You know, let's go ahead and you're looking around the cop starts looking around. It's like, you know, I'm not seeing it anywhere. And the drunk guy says, but yeah, it's because I lost it over in the park. But the lighting's better over here. Right? Seeking power in the human organization, seeking power especially in the church for Paul. Like, you know, you got it in the politics, you got it in the work, whatever. But in the church, it's like a drunk guy looking for his wallet under a streetlight. When he lost it in the park, you're in the wrong place. Because Paul says this key fundamental thing about power. Power for us as Christians is only in one place, and that is the cross of Jesus. Every other opportunity and place to seek or take power in the Christian church is against the cross of Jesus. And he goes to the point of calling them foolish, which is not a compliment, right? He calls them foolish when they seek power in some other place than the cross of Jesus. Whether they seek it in their position or they seek it in their division or they seek it in whatever method that people will choose to seek it in the church. The strong light of real power is in the cross. This is our light. This is the place where we look for what we've lost. I mean, because we have issues with our powerlessness, and we've lost perhaps some of our sense of feeling powerful. But we find real power. We find the power that we're looking for in the cross. And with the cross, what he's saying about the cross is that power in Jesus, he had all the power ever, and he gave it up. He had all the power of God sitting on his throne in heaven. He could smite you, if that's how you define power, or he could elevate you and give you all the wealth, if that's how you define power. He could do anything because he had all the power, and he gives it up, and he takes up a cross, and he says, you want power, come and take up this cross. Come and follow me. That's power. And Paul says to the church, you want power here in this world where you perhaps feel powerless. Come and take up the cross. Come and be crucified. Come and give it up. Because that's our path to power. In the name of Jesus, amen. Lord God, we thank you for your witness to us. We thank you that in times, not even in times, Lord, it's hard where our egos and our sense of self seeks power in places. And Lord, that will filter into the church. Lord, thank you for the witness of your life, the witness of your crucifixion, the witness, Lord, that the power is found when we give it up. Life is found after we're crucified. Lord, be with us to live in that life today and forever. Amen. I invite you to stand. We join in prayer.